I was originally gonna do the new Denzel Curry and Kenny Beats project Unlocked. I was gonna do a review on that. Then Tame Impala just surprised me out of nowhere, because I kind of remember seeing the date, but at the same time, I kind of forgot that it was gonna come out yesterday, because I just forgot completely. And to be honest, I just love how they released this album yesterday on Valentine's Day, because it fits perfectly. A theme that it displays here is perfect for Valentine's Day. It is so good. I love this album. I've listened to it probably three times or something yesterday, and I'm just in love with this album. I was just stuck in my mind. I couldn't go to sleep. I just wanted to review this album so badly. So yeah, Tame Impala came back after 5 years. We got Currents, 2015, the really trippy album, really psychedelic album. I love that type of sound. It was sonically pleasing. I like the vocals. But mostly what really got me hooked into Tame Impala was the production was so weird. It was such a popish, psychedelic rock type of fusion, which is so interesting and fueled my interest in Tame Impala ever since. And yeah, 5 years later, we got The Slow Rush, and it is just as psychedelic as ever. It's a bit more groovier. It has more groovy production. It still has some rock elements, some popish rock elements there, but it is mostly groovy. It consists mostly of groovy beats, these are really kind of high tempo drum patterns, these kind of high tempo beats and all, and also this reverb washy vocals from Kevin Parker again, but a little bit with more reverb this time, and it was more, feels more washy and all, but it's not necessarily a bad thing. It's actually pretty pleasant to hear. So our first track here, One More Year, which One More Year is like, it basically Kevin is telling that he has kind of one more year to be with his girl, and he says, well, let's do all the crazy stuff before that one more year passes, because apparently 1 year something is going to pass, but it is not necessarily explained in the first track that well, but apparently something's gonna happen. He wants to spend as much time as he can with his girl, do all the stupid things. It doesn't matter if it consists of doing the same thing over and over. He just wants to spend as much time as he can with this girl. And then we got to the second track, Instant Destiny, which is a banger in his production. It is such a funky type of beat. It's so groovy. It is such a nice chill beat at the same time, and it consists of Kevin mostly singing about that he's gonna do more crazy stuff with her. He wants to marry her. He's gonna have a tattoo on his arm with her name and all. He really wants to spend a lot of time with her, and it is a really pleasant song. I think that track was a huge banger. And then we got Borderline, which Borderline in this version, because I think I remember hearing this track a year ago, because there was probably 4 or 3 singles from this album. I didn't necessarily listen to every single there was. I remember listening to I Think It Might Be Time and this track as well, because I wanted to leave all the singles for when I'm listening to the entire album. And I like how Borderline has an album version that fits perfectly here. There's a little bit more of production substances. It is reverb, you know, has more of these weird psychedelic leads and all at the end and also the beginning. And yeah, it just mostly consists about Kevin talking about that and all, facing all his problems. He's apparently a drunk and alone in LA, and saying that LA was mostly the place where all his problems were, and he kind of has to face those problems, and he's questioning at the same time, will he be loved? And then we got our fourth track, Posthumous Forgiveness, which I love this track. It is one of the most emotional, sad songs from this album. It starts out with this slow, groovy, chill beat with these guitars and with these slow drums. What I like about it, it's mostly Kevin having a conversation with his father. His father will apparently kind of abandon him. But then at the chorus part, these kick starts just to thump even harder than ever in these guitars at the same time, and then it stops, and then it becomes chill again, just this slow rhythmic beat. But the lyrics, I think, are just more emotional than what the beat is trying to convey. It's like such a chill, nice beat, but at the same time, I think lyrical. It's a bit ironic because the lyrics are, as I was saying, more deeper than what it is. And this is divided kind of like in two parts. The first part I was saying is nicer. It's more chill. The production is chill. He's mostly talking about his father and all that. He kind of even misses him. And then the second part is what really steals the show. And it's mostly him, mostly the father, kind of like talking to him and saying, I fell in love with another person and I abandoned you guys because I was mostly in love with her. And what I like about Kevin is that he plays with the pitch of his voice. He sings on a higher pitch. He trying to replicate that he is like younger, I guess, and that he has moved on. He wishes he could sing those songs to his dad that he wrote and all. He wish he could spend more time with him, but he said, like, you left me, so you can't really go back. You can't really help us anymore because he with his brother is alone and all. And it's like, you can't help me at this point. I guess I could understand the posthumous forgiveness. It feels kind of like a death to him that his father left him. And the forgiveness part is like kind of like the father trying to say I'm sorry, but it's too late. And Breathe Deeper, we got a more funky, groovier type of beat here. It is a really nice beat. There's like these really nice synth leads that play around. I tried this funky guitar that plays this funky bass that plays as well. And it's mostly, this song consists about him talking to this girl and telling her, well, you need to get your stuff together. Do anything I can do for you. I'll do anything to comfort you and all, but you need to get your stuff together and then we can just go back together as one. And what I like about this track is the chorus is just so addicting to believe it. I can. Tomorrow's Dust, which I think was an okay track, it didn't necessarily blew my mind. It starts off with this kind of like funky drum type of pattern that sounds like kind of like Arabian, I don't know why, and it has this guitar playing. And it just reminds me of like this desert type of place, and it just fits perfectly because the song is called Tomorrow's Dust. And the album cover is literally some sand getting into like a house, I guess you could say. And yeah, it's kind of like him saying that whatever the problems that you had in the previous song, Breathe Deeper, it'll be Tomorrow's Dust. Whatever the air, that just negative air that happened there, like all the negative stuff that happened, it'll kind of like disintegrate and just be dust. And what really connects to this track and proves my point is that the end of this track we get like a little poorly like recorded, but it's like this in the background it's playing the Breathe Deeper song, you know, probably having a conversation with the girl. I'm assuming it's his like real life wife or something, and they probably edit that for nothing. But it could also reference that it's connection in Breathe Deeper and Tomorrow's Dust. With the next track on track, I completely love this track because how it builds up from like just these slow, mellow keys that are playing, and it builds up to be even better, more luscious, more open, such a smooth type of like chill beat, saying that even though I have these setbacks, even though I have these problems that I'm facing, I'm still on track. I want to get closer with you. Let's like put away your problems aside. I want to get closer with you. No setbacks is really gonna affect him. He needs to stay on track. He can't just get out of track. I think it was a really nice chill too, and kind of emotional. And Lost in Yesterday is actually a really nice funky tune. It's really groovy. It starts off with these slow pads that are playing, then it builds up to this super energetic drum pattern, and it's mostly saying that all those fears that you have, the fears that you had and from yesterday, from like the past and all, if it calls you, embrace them. But if it's trying to hold you too much, like if you feel they're forcing you or just pulling you, erase them, just completely destroy them. If it kind of haunts you, then just destroy it, let it go, you know. Don't let that take you in, like that don't let that control you whatsoever. And I think it was a really nice song whatsoever. It had this really nice production, and as I was saying, this funky beat again. It was really nice. It's kind of refreshing to hear more of these, like, I guess, deeper lyrics, and then this funky beat that plays, and it's so groovy. And Is It True is, I guess, the chorus segment doesn't necessarily is like mind-blowing to me. I think it was all right. But what really sticks out to me is apparently, according to Tame Impala, how they explained this song, because in the Spotify storyline, they apparently said that this song is about a perspective of this person that's kind of like nervous to say to this other girl that he likes her, to say that I care for you and all that stuff. And what, like, what Is It True was kind of like the girl saying, is it true that you kind of like me, that you have feelings for me? And apparently one of the parts, one of the verses kind of just brings the attention that maybe this whole album is a dream, because it says that, oh, it's in my, she's in my, and it just doesn't say the complete words. So it might be referencing that she's in his dream, that he is kind of dreaming all this. And he says at the end, we'll see, we'll see, we'll see, which is kind of like referencing maybe they might get together, he doesn't know, we'll see if it lasts that long. I don't know, that's kind of what the type of thing that I'm sort of listening to, or I think he's trying to say and implement in this song. It Might Be Time is probably my favorite track in this album, maybe, because not only do we have these drums that are explosive, that plays in the chorus and then cuts out for a few seconds and comes again there, I think it is also super good because it's mostly him saying, hey, it might be time to realize that nothing lasts forever. That feeling that I was having, I wanted to be with this person, maybe it wasn't that great, maybe I was overreacting this a little bit, maybe I was just feeling too much of the little fantasy that I was having, the little dream that I was having. Maybe it isn't necessarily as I expected it to be. In the chorus it said, you're not as cool as you used to be, you're not as young as you used to be. It's kind of like realizing that, hey, maybe you aren't as good as I thought you were. It might be time just to realize, as he was saying, nothing lasts forever. And I think it's kind of like a sad, it's ironic because it had like these deep lyrics, these kind of like sad lyrics at the same time as like upbeat drums that are playing. And I just feel like it's so refreshing to hear Tame Impala take a take on this. It just feels really good. In Glimmer, we have this short interlude. At the beginning, we hear Kevin, I think, in the group just talking about some production, like they should crank the bass or something. Kind of like how they're mixing the beat, I'm assuming. And then when the lyrics kick in, which is kind of like just repeated lyrics saying, I want a glimmer of hope, or I just want a glimmer of hope. That kind of repeats, I think, probably like 10 times or something. It has these effects, like these flangers that are playing, these like weird effects that just keeps panning there, and this little funky beat that plays, and it's like a 2 minute long interlude. I think it's mostly, even though it's not necessarily huge or whatever, I think it's him kind of saying, I wish something would save me right now, because right now I'm feeling kind of lost in here. I don't know what to feel at this point. And I think it's kind of pretty good for an interlude. Even though it just says, I just want a glimmer of hope, I think it's kind of saying a lot. Even though it repeats it itself, I think it's saying a lot for just an interlude. And then we got the final track, One More Hour, which this track is actually really good for like a 7 minute track. It's mostly him reflecting all his past mistakes, basically kind of like this album is reflecting all these kind of past tracks, like making all these terrible mistakes that he did and all, and that he wished he could just change it. And he was always just thinking of himself, wow, all those things I did and all for nothing, because how can I love again, because I lost interest of this girl, I can't be with her anymore, just kind of lost interest, so how am I gonna love again? And I like that in some parts there's little ad-libs that are playing to move her loser. It's kind of like, I think, his mind talking to him, and he's like kind of responding back, like I said, then how can I love again, how am I gonna do this, like how can I love this path, this is like a little bit rude and all this kind of bad, it's called a mistake of literally what I'm doing. And the chorus, which is "Ooh, love is strange," has this weird flanger effects, kind of like in Glimmer, but I guess even weirder with these guitars that are hitting super hard, these drums that are hitting really hard as well. And then like this verse comes when he just kind of like explaining that, oh, even though this girl was in his dream, it's still gonna affect him in the future, you know, that how is he gonna live in the future. He says that he's not gonna forget her, she really did a huge impact on him, and he really thanks her for being there. But what I really liked about this track is that it fades away at the end, and it might be a reference to saying that maybe he woke up from his dream, because maybe this whole album was just like a weird psychedelic dream that he was having, and it kind of like holds the future of him, of how he's going to love in the future, how he's going to encounter love, how is he gonna face it in the future and all those problems, and when is he going to, like, when he gets demotivated, what is he gonna do in the future, how he's gonna love again. And I think it was a really smart, kind of long track, but it was still really enjoyable. And the Slow Rush, the album is amazing, it is fantastic. I love the production, the psychedelic production I was saying in the beginning of this video. And also, the Slow Rush, just the title itself is perfect for the theme, because when it's even the title track, when it said 1 year later, and the end track saying 1 hour later, it's kind of like at the 57 length, it's like, it feels like it's slowly progressing, you know, but at the same time, it's kind of like the time is going on pretty fast at the same time. How smart how Tame Impala interprets that type of theme in this album, mixed with love and all, and how how time can go really fast, and at the same time it can be a little bit slow. And I think the sand that starts getting into the house kind of represents that just like one of those things. I'm sorry for that motorcycle right there. One of those things, like the sand just kind of drops and then time is out. That's probably what it's trying to represent. Like when it fades away, that probably represents that, like, the sand already is in the house, the time is up, you lost your chance. And yeah, one of the things that I was just really remembering right now is that in the final track, One More Hour, he's saying that kind of like his time is up, he doesn't have enough time to love again, so he kind of blew it. He feels like he's completely blew everything at this point. So yeah, that was my review of the Slow Rush. So I was saying, amazing album, fantastic production here. It is so psychedelic, it is just so refreshing to hear this album. Even though this kind of reverby and washy has a lot of delays in the vocals and all, I think their production really takes a lot of the music and all, but their vocals in this album are also really deep and really emotional and really interesting how they play out. And it's kind of smart how they use time and love at the same time in this album. Now, as I was saying in the beginning, I love that it's dropped in Valentine's Day. It just forms a really mature love story that they have here. So yeah, that was my review. What will I give the Slow Rush? Easily a 9 out of 10. I just love this album so much. It is great. It is fantastic. It is amazing. You guys should definitely check this album out. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. Be sure to hit that like button down below. Subscribe. Turn the notification bell on. And see you next time. Peace out.